You are joined here by Eric July of Backwordz and Being Libertarian, and myself, Paul Gordon. I'm with a lot of things, but if you want to know anything, just go to istv.me. All my stuff is there. So I want to ask you a question first, Eric, before we begin. I want to see like the degree to which you and I are on the same page as far as what I call my framework of preference. So the first question I have to ask you is, do you prefer that human beings live?
Absolutely. That's
you're
automatic.
Not necessarily.
Not pro life. Like don't use that term. Gonna get us in trouble.
People
gonna be in the comments thinking that we're they're talking about abortion and
not today.
Yeah, not today.
So you're pro humans living.
Yeah, right? Absolutely.
That's a good starting point. If you said no to that, this probably would have went a dark turn. So the second thing is, do you prefer, and I understand I'm going to use a subjective term here, but however you understand this word, do you prefer that humans prosper?
Yes, absolutely. Yes, I think that's it's an easy term to go off of. Absolutely. When you talk about why it is that I advocate what I advocate for, in terms of definitely, you know, when I always talk about private, people think I'm joking and shit when I always talk about privatization of pretty much everything moving and not moving. But it's the reason behind it is because I do want human beings to prosper. And I do feel as if their ability to be able to prosper is more, I guess, suited for a society in which everybody is free. So the fact that
I actually gets to my third one.
Right.
And the third one, which I'm pretty sure I already knew, kind of knew in advance that you were
going to agree
with these, but I just wanted
to set for the listeners.
Right. Yeah. So the third thing is, do you prefer that human beings have the greatest opportunity to make their own choices with as little, I'll say, as little physical coercion as possible?
Absolutely. 100%.
So
100%.
So you and I, we agree 100%. With these three frameworks.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that you and I agree that the path that we've been under for thousands of years, the coercive enterprise path, the state path, whatever you want to call it, not helping you and I get to our goal.
No, I mean, they prevent it. they literally prevent it.
So everything for me, everything that I'm going to talk about with you, or I'm going to ask you and try to understand, and above all else, I want to understand your perspective.
Absolutely.
And hopefully I'll help you understand my perspective as well. So the first part I want to get to with this is, do you believe that the conversation that we're having within the anarchist community, the debate that you see ongoing between open borders and closed borders, do you believe that the amount of energy that's being put into that, is it too much energy, too little energy, or are we at Goldilocks?
Well, I think that, and that's a great question, by the way. I don't think people should, and again, I don't want to dictate what it is somebody's types of, I guess, activism should or should not be. Now, I will talk about my particular preference, and that definitely amongst other people that are already thinking like me, it's not the most, I wouldn't put all my energy absolutely in having a conversation about that. Because if you're already an anarchist or you're already a libertarian, then we're on the same side already. So trying to convince each other is not really or spending a lot of time trying to convince each other for an end game that we already believe in is not the best use of our scarce resources, as there are the majority of people, definitely with any geographical area that I've ever lived in, most of them don't believe that. You know what I mean? So I think my energy is more suited for trying to get through to them, no matter the subject, whether the subject be on borders and or anything else. Now, I do think that there's a lot of energy being spent, but I will say, well, amongst the anarchist community talking about borders, but I will say, I think a lot of it stems from people talking right past each other. And I
believe that's true.
Yeah. And talking right past each other. So because they're talking right past each other. I think and I think that's where most of the energy goes, is that a lot of people are getting, because they're talking past each other, you have misunderstandings, miscommunication. Definitely when you get on the internet, stuff like that, or with the nonverbal cues just not being
right.
there,
yeah.
It's huge. You know what I mean? Because you can absolutely misunderand people's points. So I think that's what's more so happened. I think even often when I see people get into these arguments, they're well intended, I would like to think. But again, because they're talking past each other and there's a slight misunderstanding as to what the, you know, what's going on, I think that's more of where the energy is being wasted. But regardless, if that's being the case, what I've tried to get better at doing as a libertarian and as an anarchist is to sometimes stop myself when I get into those little petty arguments with people that are already think, like, if they're already an ANCAP, like, you've already been convinced. It's not my, what am I wasting a lot of my scarce resources, the most scarce resource being my time, trying to convince you to an end game that you've already came to, when I'm going to go home and the people around me don't think anything like this. I would think if I'm going to leave my mark on this earth, my time is best suited for those guys and trying to convince them to get on our side, as opposed to us working out the small kinks that we might have in some type of disagreement in application or disagreement in how we get to this point. You know what I mean? So I think it's a lot of that happening to a lot of different people, but definitely with me, I'm trying to get better at that and utilizing my efforts towards it. It is, absolutely.
It is difficult, not, and I mean, I it happens to me. When you get emotional, and I do at times, definitely, and actually more so on Facebook, when you get emotional, you're clouded. And then you start to look for what you want to be and not what is. And it happens to the best of us where, I mean, to a certain degree, it happened in a conversation that I had with you where, and actually, this is kind of what led to this show. Actually, it was that interaction where you posted a quote from Murray Rothbard. And actually, I wasn't misunderstanding you, by the way. I do want to clarify that. I was misunderstanding the Murray Rothbard quote.
Mm-hmm.
I read that quote very differently. And I did read it all. And I read it thinking, dude, I'm trying to be fair. I'm trying to understand. I'm trying. But there was an emotion immediately when I looked at your post, which I didn't identify right away. But that emotion, it definitely clouded the way I read that article. And that article, I ended up producing in my mind what I wanted that article to say.
Mm-hmm.
And I believe that the Murray Rothbard quote was essentially saying that what you're saying, which is closed borders and open borders is not a libertarian issue.
Right.
However, in proposed, which I don't necessarily agree with him, but I don't think his reasoning is out of bounds, or I mean, it's a valid theory, is in a libertarian community, you're probably going to have, you're not going to have that free travel that everybody thinks you're going to have. I think you're going to have, you and I probably disagree on the degree to which we believe free travel. But then again, maybe we don't. Maybe I shouldn't assume, right?
Mm-hmm. So, with me, I mean, as far as what the quote definitely that I posted was that he was saying that, you know, basically what I've been saying is that the fact that when we talk about borders, whether it be open or closed or slash restricted, neither one of those are libertarian positions. And the reason why he was saying what he was saying was that the immigration discussion, which is essentially what a lot of the open borders, quote unquote, discussion is about, he says it gets resolved in a libertarian, definitely an anarcho-capitalist model, as in that, you know, people can neatly to settle. Basically, that's the term that he used. He said it would be neatly settled. And, you know, as far as what I've been saying on free movement, look, I would never leave a conversation. I think it's a bad, bad position, a bad argument, definitely for anybody that calls himself an ANCAP to lead with that. Because that doesn't exist.
I noticed that you say a word. You say it all the time. And that is ANCAP. Why do you say ANCAP as opposed to anarchist?
No, well, I say ANCAP because I don't want to be, I'm not a communist. You know what I mean? I say anarchist all the time, but my thing is,
ANCAP or ANCOM?
Yeah. ANCAP and ANCOM are two different things. And when I say I say anarchist, it's not like I'm afraid to say it. The reason why I always say, why I tend to say ANCAP is more so people know exactly where I'm coming from with what it is that I advocate. I don't want it to be any kind of, because again, with all these different, you know, hyphenations and all of that, it's this different kinds of people calling themselves anarchists. In a lot of cases, I don't believe in what they believe in to any extent, like people that go around calling themselves anarcho-communists. So that's the only reason why I would ever use ANCAP, is because, again, it's a more, to specify what it is that I adopt. But going back to the situation about Rothbard, he's saying that this would be in a privatized, in an anarcho-capitalist model, and that's what he was going off of when he's saying basically everything is privatized. He's saying this does not exist. This closed,
I'm enjoying
closed borders.
Your post, by the way. Yeah. Privatized Mars or
yeah, you know, I'm saying privatized everything. Like I said, if it moves and it don't move, I want it privatized. Yeah. But on a serious note, and I love the way that he words it, because he's saying, look, he said this free kind of access to something, it doesn't exist. If everything is privatized, basically he was talking about whether it be with movement or anything, usage of people's private property is still going to be left up to the property owner. You know what I mean? What we're having a conversation about now is the opposite of that. And that's, I think, where a lot of the, whether it be confusion or disagreements and stuff like that come from, because the state right now essentially robs people to to enforce whatever border policy whatever border policy. You can't privatize the land. If I want to go on that land and, you know, privatize it, you know, I'm going to run into some issues when it comes to the state. So it doesn't matter what their policy is. That the fact that they enforce that is what makes them a nation state. So what Rothbard was talking about, and this is the point that I've been trying to hammer home with people that are on both sides of this discussion, whether it be open borders or closed borders, is that privatization is, neither one of those are libertarian positions, and privatization is, it resolves this conflict that we run into, because everything you have, you can either homestead it or you've achieved it, use of it via voluntary exchange, and your access to it is going to be dependent on that. So it might be somebody that may have a road or something like that. And me personally, I think that would be something that I would invest in immediately in any kind of libertarian society.
If you were a few months ahead of time and you knew,
yeah, like I'd be,
dude, I'm buying me some roads.
I'm getting some roads, man. I'm getting some roads because I know people need to travel. You know what I mean? I'm getting to those. So I'll get to those roads. But either way, as a road owner or something like that, whether it be a road or anything, land, whatever you want to call it, whoever gets to use that is still up to me. I can loosely regulate it. I could heavily regulate it and say, you need to have this, this, and that. You know what I mean? Whatever might be more cost effective to what it is that I'm trying to accomplish as a property owner with that road. But ultimately, regardless, as the property owner, somebody's ability to use it, or not necessarily ability, more so right to use it, is still left up to me as a property owner, and vice versa. If I'm trying to use somebody's, utilize somebody else's land or utilize somebody else's road
like that. There's another element in that. And this is, by the way, one of the reasons that I don't think everything will be privatized. I don't think it's always going to be privatized versus public. I think it's going to be privatized versus, no one can really demonstrate a legitimate homesteading over this particular plot of land. In addition to your will to want to stop people from traveling on your road, it's the practical ability for you to enforce that will. And I believe there's going to be vast tracts of land, even if they're privatized, it's going to be really difficult.
Yeah, people might be using. Yeah, I mean, that happens now. I mean, again, I don't think there's going to be any kind of ideal. Well, no, I don't want to say that there's not any kind of ideal standard, because I think privatization is the ideal standard. Yes, there will be people that will. And I think in how that is privatized is going to determine how people benefit off of it as a property owner, whether it be from, again, if I realize that it's a road or something like that, is that not an obstacle that I run into when I say, well, how can I tightly regulate this? You know, how
might cost it too much.
Yeah, yeah, exactly. Exactly. Right. It might cost me too. Is this something that I really want to be spending my money on? So I think no matter what it is, whatever land it is that they say is theirs or as a property owner, that's going to be dependent on what it is that they own, you know, how it is that they regulate it and stuff like that. You know what I mean? So that's what I obviously what I advocate. But I think that's just how it works in terms of a privatized a libertarian society or what have you. You know what I mean? A lot of that is going to be dependent on what type of land or what type of property that they have privatized in terms of, you know, how are they going to allow other people access to it. You know what I mean? I think that's a big thing. Devil of a Rose, like you just said, and the point that I was alluding to was that it might not be cost effective for me to have a road and just really, really tightly regulate who is on it. So let's go about other ways to make this feasible, not only for me, you know, but for everybody else.
Yeah, you got to offer a product people will want to use.
Exactly.
Right?
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. And who wants to use a road that, and maybe there are people that would pay for, but, you know, I would think it's going to be very difficult.
If it's in a primo spot for a limited space, you could probably regulate that puppy a lot.
Right. Yeah.
A lot easier. So, in some of the interactions that we have, which I actually think you and I have been talking past each other, and maybe it's part you, maybe it's part me, maybe it's all me, I don't know. But I think that what I'm trying to understand is, and I think if I understand it, I might learn something from it, is obviously I would say, well, let me ask you, do you think that some degree of anarchists, and I understand for you, you're an outreach guy. You're primarily concerned with how do you reach beyond the echo chamber, which I get that. Now, you're actually on one of my shows in which I'm actually focused on anarchists. Most of my shows actually are outreach shows. This one, though, is different.
Right.
But you obviously believe, I think that let me ask you, do you believe that there is a constructive reason why it is that anarchists should have a discussion about what helps liberty more, if the government is enforcing a closed border policy or if the government is imposing an open border policy? And obviously, that doesn't mean you're advocating for it, but this would be a very pragmatic argument, right?
Right.
It's kind of like...
Well, I think there's a conversation, at least, to be had, definitely when it, you know, not just... I mean, from an outreach standpoint, I absolutely think that, and I would actually encourage anarchists to engage into this conversation. You know what I mean? Because no matter what side of the issue that you are on, there are people on it that aren't libertarians, whether it be more so of a restricted or closed border policy or from a just leave the junts wide open. It's and I think it's important to be able to give a libertarian perspective on it, definitely when you're out there talking to other people. So
and I'm with you there.
Yeah, you know what I mean?
I'm not so with you with the anarchists debating this, although it could be. I'm interested to hear.
The only reason I would see an anarchist debate, and again, outreach is my number one thing. The only reason I would see an anarchist even engaging in this conversation is, again, to learn more about the position itself. Because a lot of these positions are very, very complex. And I think that definitely for those that study...
Yeah, the border is very complex.
Yeah,
it's a complex...
It's not a black and... I wish it was. I damn sure wish it was. But it's not necessarily a black and white issue. So engaging in these conversations, I think, helps other... If you're going into it with the intent to learn something, definitely from the libertarian perspective, I might pick up something from a person that's, you know, talking about borders in his community that maybe thought this through a lot more than I have, and it comes from both sides. So I can take that and go argue, not necessarily argue that, but bring that information that I've newly gathered for people that maybe study this or people that have dove into this and given perspectives that I may not have considered, and take that going into a conversation with somebody that is, again, I'm trying to reach and bring them over to my side as a libertarian, because they're not their status.
Right.
And I use that in a more of a literal sense. So that to me, and it doesn't matter whether it be about the border situation or any other thing, I would, if you know, definitely if it's, because that's a hot topic. It's a hot topic. I mean,
well, it's a form of political culture jamming, right?
Yeah, yeah. It's absolutely a hot topic. So I do dig the fact, and I've seen this. Don't get it twisted, though. I've seen a lot of people jumping down each other's throat. I think a lot of people have went into the conversation with absolutely no intentions of considering what the other person had to say. And I think that that type of communication, definitely if you're going to be able to take this to somebody else, I think there's a lot that you can take from that. And that's exactly what I do. If I'm going to waste my time, it's not waste time, if I'm going to utilize the most scarce resource I have to argue a position that we didn't generally when it comes to an ideal setup, we already agree. The only thing that I can pick up is that, all right, because what happened is definitely on the border situation, hearing people discuss it, what it did for me was allow me to, when I go to, now I can go discuss this issue and actually see where it is that they're coming from. Why do you fear this if the government takes a policy one way or the other, or one maybe in the middle? Yeah. Why do you fear that? Why is that bad to you? And seeing these other people have these conversations, they start mimicking maybe some of the positions that other people might fear. And this is the same thing with taxation and stuff like that. If I'm talking to somebody that definitely those conservative types who think that, well, oh, we gotta have this and don't like it, leave, but we gotta have this.
Well, don't go to Somalia. They're bombing that
yeah,
right now.
Yeah, exactly. You know, we have to have this. And if we didn't have it, the world would just blow up, whether it be some type of police officers and stuff like that. You know, why it is that they think like that is stuff. A lot of that conversation comes from me just, you know, having random conversations with people that are already on my side, and I take that over. Okay, I see what it is that you're saying. But let's consider this. You know what I mean? I know you fear this because of this, but let's consider this. I think communication is a key, man. Communication is huge if we are going to win people on our side. So I think that the border discussion can be one that is productive. I think often it is not. Do not get it twisted. I think we both agree that a lot of that stuff is not.
I have on my friends list, if there's going to be a debate about what's better for liberty, I'm probably going to argue for open borders. Like, I'm going to say, in a pragmatic sense, I believe that liberty has the best chance in an open borders mm-hmm. world. But I can honestly say I'm not 100% sure, because mm-hmm. there are pitfalls with open borders that
was my position, though, Paul. Like, that what you just said, that was exactly my position years ago, is that I would have leaned that way automatic. But then again, just doing more thorough research, having this
I've kind of went in the other direction.
It's kind of like, well, why is this a default? Like that was more so the question that I was asking. I was like, why the hell is this is open for policy? Why is this exactly a default when you consider that even a lot of the issues that arise from a closed border policy, like, again, the prevention of privatization, you come across that same damn issue if in an open border policy.
Now, when it comes to open versus closed, I actually went in the opposite journey that you did. I started off closed borders.
Oh, okay.
And then I moved over to the other side. However, when I say that I've moved over to the other side, I would never, and I don't think you would do this either, I would never stake my existential being on a position that I'm right, that open borders is going to give us the best opportunity, or closed borders for that matter.
Absolutely.
I may have my own preferences as to why I favor open borders. I don't know. But mm-hmm. I will say one of the biggest reasons that I wanted you on this show was, as you could probably figure out by now, is not to say, okay, what's better, open or closed borders for liberty. Mm-hmm. It's really what I see going on. What frustrates me and what you get from me sometimes in some of the interactions, why I get passionate, is mm-hmm. because I see this debate destroying connections mm-hmm. and friendships. I see people blocking each other all over the place. I've blocked.
Fair enough.
I've actually ended up blocking a couple of folks, but I been blocked way more than I've blocked. But the people that I am actually friends. I am within, you know, in Facebook world, you know, I'm friends with staunch closed border supporters. And I can have conversations with them. Sometimes they get passionate. But but we're not calling each other commies and Nazis.
Right.
You know, we're not telling each other you're not a real anarchist if you don't believe this. It's like, so what you're saying is you want to take a position that somebody's an anarchist or not an anarchist based on whether they think a state action will be beneficial to liberty or not. Because either action is a fundamental violation of liberty standards.
Exactly.
Exactly.
And that I will agree with you 100%, Paul. I've seen friendships breaking up. And this is where I think you have a big point when you if you lean towards a you know maybe this isn't the we shouldn't be putting the most time in this in amongst the anarchist community because what you see is a lot of people that have literally the same end game but because
they have literally
the same end game but because our preference is different. Considering the reality of the political climate now, they will destroy each other.
Right, and there's a preference, and then there's, okay, you have a set of facts and figures. I have a set of facts and figures. Neither one of us is capable. I mean, I've never read – well, actually, I've read most of Human Action a long time ago when I wasn't an anarchist.
That's one of the points that he was mentioning, right?
But this whole book. You cannot calculate it all.
Yeah, it's impossible. That's the problem with central planning, right? That's the problem. That's exactly the problem, with central planning.
So you're failure. But and for me, I'll let you know a little bit about me. You've been on when I did Dissociation Nation with Niz. Mm-hmm. You've been on that show a couple times. I have two things that I love the most to do in the anarchist community. One is actually like you, I love outreach. That's why my friend Andrew Merich and I, we do a show called Lozilla. And Lozilla, we end up somehow talking about anarchy and liberty to some degree, but mostly what we talk about is we talk about celebrities. We talk about weird news, weird tech stuff, but you know, culture jamming, you know, let's talk beyond. I love that part. But the other part that I love, and it has to do with my understanding of the reality of power and the necessity for having individuals to walk with you and to have, I'm very big on the idea of, I don't like the idea of unity. I think unity is kind of scary, collectivist, weird. Everybody's got to walk the same, talk the same. I mean, you and I, we're both Christians. I think you and I can be united in Christ, but not in anarchy. What we can have are doors open, or pathways, doors, whatever you want to call it, to possible opportunities for cooperation in the future. Mm-hmm. Now, in the future. And what I'm seeing is all of these pathways that for so many people that could possibly cooperate it's being shut off and it's being shut off over a debate that isn't a reflection of liberty. However, I want to say in the last couple of days, I did have a thought since I've been talking to you and a few others that what I reflect is this is just my preference. This is just my opinion. I am not I made a joke a long time ago. I was making fun of people who kind of declare anarchy this. And I am Pope Paulus Anarchist the 17th. There is no Pope, but you know, I am not the Pope of Anarchy. So don't get upset if I say something that you disagree with, although you can, I don't care. But I think that there is something that is constructive that will bridge gaps beyond the ANCAP world that will actually reach out to, I won't say ANCOMs, but I'll say some more left-leaning anarchist, what you would call left-leaning. I don't really like thinking in terms of left and right, but, and that is, what I've been thinking about, the property that's owned by government, what the heck happens to it?
What happens to it?
That is a legitimate question for anarchists to talk about. I mean, I don't know. I don't think that we're going to be able to 100% certain say what's going to happen. I think the spontaneous order may surprise us.
I think it will surprise us, man. I mean, it's, and I will say there are some people that are having that discussion. And I think that's probably the more, maybe more productive discussion to have if we're going to be discussing. And I have seen people bring it up. It's like, who would get first dibs? If not the people, you know, would it be the people that live there? Would it be the people that, you know, is there some way to prove that, you know, you were, I don't know how they would prove that. I mean, maybe from a libertarian legal theory standpoint, I guess the first people that would technically have dibs are the people that I guess are owed the restitution, which would be the taxpayer. You know what I mean? But how do you prove how much you put, went to that? You know, it's tough.
I like what Luffy posted recently. He was talking about, well, you know, and he's being facetious here. He says, well, all we have to do is, we have to get the government agents to go through their records and track exactly who paid what and help us.
If they could do that.
They won't dissolve themselves.
Yeah, I mean, they're going to burn the records. That would be awesome.
They're going to burn the records on the way out.
Yeah, that's going to be tough. I mean, yeah, that'd be you know, handing us the solution right there on a silver platter.
Yeah, it's probably not going to happen.
But
it is an interesting question. What happens?
It's a tough one, and that's a productive conversation, I guess, to be had, because that's a difficult one. Again, I mean, from a libertarian, I guess, from the legal theory sense, you would think that again, the person that would literally be the case, the person that if you can prove that this person was taxed and their tax money went to this, then I guess they would have dibs on it first, and they might say, I don't want anything to do with it, and then maybe leave it to Homestead or whatever. I don't know. But like you mentioned, I don't think it would be handed to us on a silver platter like that. But that's a great question to be had. And I've seen some people sort of bring that up, but not really diving into it, because we really can't get past
we can't get past open or closed.
Yeah, we can't get past that. You know what I mean?
We can't get past Nazis and commies.
Yeah, we can't. We can't get past, you know, again, destroying entire friendships. I mean, well, even if you don't consider it a friendship, I mean, people that were at least
connections.
You know, connections and people that were.
Opportunities for cooperation are being cut off. And it's not like there's a whole lot of us to start off with.
Right.
And, you know, our exchange of information and resources is, I think, our greatest asset. Mm-hmm. And, I think you and I, I've talked, you had said that, I've seen you say, you talk about division. Division isn't necessarily bad. I agree. Division is not necessarily bad. I mean, the United States government tried to desegregate the population in an incredibly artificial way. It was like no division. It didn't work out. It just doesn't work out. So division isn't necessarily a bad thing. But and I'll say, within my framework of perspective that we started off with, I have a vested interest in seeing as many people as possible who have that fundamental. They agree they want humans to live. They agree they want humans to prosper. They agree they want humans to have the greatest opportunity to make the greatest free will choices that they possibly can, with the least bit of physical coercion as possible. If you believe in those things, I think you and I, maybe sometime you can come on another show, maybe with me and Bodie, and we can talk about property. Because I think you and I, we might have some differences. My difference with you actually would be in uncertainty, where you have certainty. But I think that we can have that difference, so long as I'm not offering coercion in response. I'm not seeking to coercively force you into my understanding. I believe that property is very, very I don't believe in property rights. I believe in property standards. And the key difference is that I don't believe that there's an absolute justification for property, but there is an absolute justification for property for me within my framework of preference, within a framework of preference of wanting the most amount of people to have the greatest opportunity to make their own choices. I believe property standards is where it's at. And we might not be fully aligned, but I believe, I think, I don't want to speak for you, but I think that we're aligned enough that if you and I, like, I think when I have a conversation with you on Facebook, I think by and large, we've been, you know, even when we disagree, we know. Nobody's throwing bombs at anybody.
Yeah, right? Absolutely. Yeah.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. 100% right.
So we're keeping open opportunities for cooperation. We might never ever, I might never ever talk to you again. We might never have another opportunity for cooperation. It might not happen, but hey, the door's open.
Right.
Because we didn't shut anything. Yeah.
Yeah.
Right. And I mean, so for me, that is, if you're listening, whoever's watching us right now, you're thinking about them. Let me ask you this. What is your advice? How can we have a better conversation in which we're not some relationships need to be nuked. Let's be honest. Absolutely. But where we're not nuking relationships that really, the only reason they were nuked is because one or two of you were consumed by your own passion. How do we avoid that?
Right. Right. That's a great question. I mean, it's a great question, and it's one that needs to be had, because there are some people that have, and that to me of all is weird. Because I see, at least I don't approach it like that. I never will approach it like that to where I will, just because we disagree on a preference. If even like we can say if there's 100 things that we agree with, but there's, I mean,
10?
One, you know, whatever number of things that we might have a different even in the end game, we actually agree. So you can say it's 100% that we agree. But just because in a preference, because I think what we're really discussing is the political climate is as it is today. You know what I mean? And because the state exists. All right, what is going to get us to liberty?
Right.
And that's when the preferences say, all right, well, I would prefer this, I would prefer that. And people start saying, even if, again, the end game is literally the same.
But I think we're not talking just about preference there in that context. I think we're also talking about, hey, I actually believe this will work better. Well, no, I believe, for instance, I don't believe there's any reason whatsoever to participate in any kind of political, outside of outreach to non-anarchists, I don't believe necessarily that engaging in political action is really all that helpful. I'm not going to nuke someone and say they're not an anarchist or whatever if they say, you know, I think it'll work. I'm like, okay, well, you go ahead and try that. Go, right. Good luck.
Yeah, and that's another one that I've seen people when the election cycle. It was another. I saw people nuking conversations, nuking entire friendships because one person said, you know what, look, I think if, you know, whether it be with the Libertarian Party or the Republican Liberty Caucus, I know some anarchists that are actually literally in the Republican Liberty Caucus. And they say, you know, look, this is my way. And they usually have some sort of proof that says, look, I helped this person come to liberty by being a member. I mean, me personally, I don't participate in, you know, I haven't participated in politics for a little bit now. And that's just not what I do, but I'm not going, definitely if they have provable strides that have been made, I think maybe their efforts are best utilized elsewhere, but I'm not going to say that this person is not a libertarian or not an anarchist or something like that, simply because they think that even though the end game is the same, they think there's a stride to be made there. We can disagree. We can say that, you know, we can talk about what's more effective, which position is going to get us to liberty first, I guess. But sitting here nuking entire conversations and friendships, that's just insane. Just because we disagree on that one aspect, I think that's insane.
Yeah, and that's, I mean, I'm a connector by nature. I like connecting people. And so that maybe that helps you understand a little bit why, for me, this is a passionate issue. But it's not because I am not doggedly defending open borders. Right. I am doggedly defending connections. I have connections with people, maybe a couple people that you wouldn't even want to be connected with. I have connections with people in the anarchist community across the hyphenated sphere. Mm-hmm. And my one test with them is this. and this is, if you fail this test, I am not going to walk with you in anarchy. And that is, do you advocate for violence to achieve your goal? If you advocate for violence to achieve your goal, you and I, I can stay connected to you to a certain extent, but my connection to you is about trying to witness true liberty to you. It's not about walking with you in anarchy. That's my one test. And I have a belief that for me, fundamentally, if I believe that the free market is absolutely the best opportunity for individuals to be able to make that free choice, to have the most options without coercive involvement. I believe individual property is the path, but I'm not 100% sure that in spontaneous order as it emerges, that you're not going to see something that will surprise you that you haven't even thought about. And if you want to go ahead and try something that I'll look at and I'll be like, dude, it's not going to work, I say, go ahead and try it, man. The marketplace of ideas, go ahead. As long as you're not taking coercive action, go ahead and try it. I'm going to tell you, you're going to freaking implode. If you want to try to build a collectivist ownership, I believe personally that is the road to nowhere. But I'm not going to disconnect from you if you want to do that, unless you advocate for. And I have to say, the folks that call themselves ANCOM, I won't say all of them, but a fair amount of them, they eventually, if you talk to them long enough, for, at least in my experience, I have discovered violence comes into play as far as an advocation for.
Shit, man, that's usually automatic with me. So you giving them, I guess your conversations are maybe a little different than mine. So usually for me, it's automatic. Every conversation I've had, that's why I've got to the point to where I say, man, I ain't even wasting my time with like that. There's a select group of people that I would just say, look, I have no desire to even attempt, because I already know where you're coming from. You know what I mean? Like on some violent shit. Excuse my language, but I'm not going there.
Violence is not.
You know what I mean? Like, I'm not going there with you. You have, I'm not even about to attempt to reason with that. You know what I mean? And usually it comes from that bunch, you know, of people. Seldom, you know what I mean? There might be one, and I just want to leave it. I can't think of it off the top of my head. You know what I mean? I'm just going to leave it open because I don't want to put my foot in my mouth. But, you know, at least from my knowledge, as far as my recent memory, man, there's no conversation with any sort of communist has been good. You know what I mean?
Right. I mean, generally speaking, folks that come from the ANCOM perspective, I've actually had more success talking to folks that maybe people would consider in that camp, although I don't know necessarily that they call themselves ANCOMs, but people would call them ANCOMs. But I've had good, constructive conversations with folks, which is, by the way, why in and of itself, the conversation about open or closed borders, I'm actually for having all conversations. When I see conversations that, from my perspective, don't look like they're bearing fruit, I'm not as interested in that. But I like asking, you know, Tom Woods. You're going to be on the Tom Woods show. Yeah. Dude, you're going to be on the 1,000th episode.
Yeah, that's going to be fun. And that's going to be fun, man. I'm really excited.
I'll look forward to listening to that. That's awesome. And what's he talk about? The you know, going off the, what is the exact phrase? Going off the 3x5 card of allowable opinion. Anarchist. Yeah. Anarchists have allowable opinion.
You're right.
And they have their own 3x5 card. I like going off the 3x5 card. I like sometimes, if I don't know how much you read my Facebook page, but I put stuff out there. I like, I believe this? I don't know. I throw it out there. Let's see what I learn. So something that goes outside of the parameters of what most anarchists would most anarchists would accept as you know, like, even like I'd love to have you back on. I'm not going to get a commitment from you, but after Midwest Peace and Liberty Fest, maybe in a few weeks, I would love to have you on another show that I do with Tyagananda Swaraj. You see him there commenting, and Andrew Marich, And I would love to talk about property.
Okay.
And the nature of property and some of the philosophical ramifications of property. I think, I mean, that'd be a fascinating conversation, you know?
For sure.
I mean, I take a very pragmatic approach when it comes to property, but I find it extremely useful.
Yeah, no, I'm always up for having these conversations, man. So just let me know if I'm free with it, man. Just hit me up.
Yeah, I will. I think that we've reached the end. I think personally that I'm hoping that what I wanted out of this conversation in the beginning was for anybody that might be listening now or videos in the future, is if maybe our conversation that you and I have, you and I, we're not completely enmeshed with each other.
Mm-hmm.
We're not. And that's okay. You and I could still be friends, and we still have opportunities for cooperation, because neither one of us has nuked one another, invalidated the other, declared the other an anarchist or a non-anarchist, a Nazi or a commie or a statist.
Yeah.
It's like, okay, you know, we don't necessarily agree. I think I'm right about open borders and about being, I'll say, open borders providing more opportunity for liberty to grow than closed borders. But I'm open mm-hmm. to that discussion. And I'm by the way, if anybody ever wants to come on the show and actually have that discussion, I'm open to that as well.
Right.
But I don't think that you and I disagree on the fundamentals.
No, and that's
we're arguing over whether is it better to get kicked in the nuts or punched in the throat?
Yeah,
I don't know, man. Like that kick in the nuts is gonna help.
We both agree. We both agree on the end game, and I think that is, to me, when I'm having these discussions, I guess that's what I lead with. You know what I mean? It's going to be telling of the relationship, the type of relationship that one is going to have with another individual. And I try to approach everybody as an individual as much as I can. If we can agree on the basics, then it's awesome. You know, let's start there. And I try to keep that in mind, even through our disagreements. Try to keep that in mind, no matter who it is.
Yeah,
that way,
but it's difficult because sometimes,
yeah, it is.
Sometimes when somebody is telling you, I mean, I've done this. I'm not, we've all done this for,
me too. We're all, nobody's above this logic.
Right. If somebody's telling you something like you're stupid, you're an idiot, you don't have your information right, all of a sudden it's not just about trying to understand something. It's like, whoa, this is an existential threat. Your opinion about my worthlessness is now suddenly what I'm going to fight about. that's what the fight becomes about instead of something which I absolutely think going forward, I would love to see more conversations about what does happen to the government land.
Mm-hmm.
I think that's a conversation.
Great conversation. Yeah. Great conversation. I mean, and it might be a lot more productive than some of the nonsense that I see going on now, unfortunately. You know what I mean?
Right. So
and it sucks. It is nonsense. I think we both can agree.
Yeah. Unless somebody is a card carrying communist or a card carrying Nazi, I'm for one will I guess the best that I'll say is I think you're kind of going down the commie road. Or I think you're kind of going down the Nazi road, but I'm not gonna call you that.
I'm not gonna call you that, man. Just
saying,
be careful, man.
You're on the bus. bus to Berlin or the bus to Moscow, dude. Get off the freaking bus.
Sure, man. I'm with you, man. I'm with you on that.
so before I leave here, what do you have going on in the near future with Being Liberty and Army?
Right now we're about to launch a new website. We have the original website, but you'll be able to get it by whether it be beinglibertv.com as well as beinglibertarian.tv, in which we're going to launch, and you will be able to see, we obviously have our podcasts and stuff like that, but you're going to see a lot of more videos, and maybe people that are following us right now, we've been having a lot of videos come out, a lot more contributors and stuff like that, starting to get a little more professionalized and stuff. So that's really been my focal point for the last, since we got off our last tour. some months ago, that's been my focal point in trying to, because I am the head of multimedia for this
entire
brand.
You are the head
of
multimedia.
You know what I mean? So it's my responsibility. it's my responsibility. So make sure that I get that done has been top priority, because we go on tour again in a couple of months, I believe in August. So I have to make sure that, you know, this gets off the ground so it's smooth sailing at some point. So we'll be launching that, and obviously the band itself, which seems like a lot of more people care about that than my actual commentary.
I actually care more about the commentary. Although I like the band, I bought the CD, but I actually care more about the commentary.
That seems like, you know, people, a lot more people talk about that.
Well,
you
that
know
makes that, sense. So,
which is fine. I'm not saying they're in the wrong for doing that. But yeah, we do the band Vanna. For those that listen to hardcore music, they are wrapping it up. They're doing a farewell tour, and we'll be on that. And it starts in Toronto, and we'll be working our way on down. I can't remember the exact date that it starts in August, but you can obviously go to backwardsmusic.com or go to our Facebook page and get all of those dates that we'll be at. And hope to see. In the last tour, we saw a lot of familiar faces in the Liberty Movement that came to support us, and came obviously to see, it was a great ticket in itself, but came to see the other bands as well. So hope to see some more people this upcoming tour in August. And of course, we'll have some more announcements with music videos and also more tours going on in the fall and the winter.
What's the name of the video? I'm embarrassed. What's the name of the video that you shot where the dude is with the megaphone?
Self-ownership.
Oh, it is self-ownership. I thought it's self-ownership. Yeah. Like, no, it's not self-ownership. Don't sound like an idiot. Don't say that. Yeah, no, but I was right. So I'm a strange fellow. I'll admit it. I keep a top 100 ranking of my favorite top 100 songs because of the OCD. It's, you got to do it. And you guys are rising in the charts. You're at number 20. You're at number 23 right now on Paul Corden's top 100.
I love it.
Congratulations. And you're heading up.
Appreciate that, man. No, that's what it's about, man. I'm actually, that's awesome, man. So, man, and with you guys, man, within our community, it's been a lot of people that have supported us. I've said time and time again that this libertarian anarchist community is the backbone of Backwordz. I mean, it's a lot of most of our supporters that have launched us into a lot of opportunities that I would never have had. You know what I mean? We got a lot of opportunities to perform, like again with these last tours that we've been hopping on, to really get this message out to people that have never even heard of these concepts that I've been talking about, and for me to get on.
It's really effective culture jamming. I love it. Now
I'm all about it.
I do want to thank you for helping me with my daughter, and you knew nothing about it, but you know, ripples. I'm watching my top 100 video countdown, because once I make the list, I get to watch the list. I spend all day. I work usually, and I play my list. It's awesome. And your video came on, and my daughter's kind of jamming to it. She's enjoying it. I was like, yeah, you know, you see those guys? Because I know you and I know Alex. I said, yeah, I know those guys. So I name dropped you with my daughter. My daughter, she walked away. She was a little bit huffy. She walked away a little bit huffy. And I'm like, dude, why'd you walk away? She says, you're cooler than me. So you helped me. You gave me cool points with my daughter, dude. That's
absolutely awesome.
So I thank you for that. So I want to thank you very much for being on iState here. iState advocating for a state of I. That's a small I. And if you want to find, I will post this show. It's on, obviously, the archive will be on the Liberty Principle. It's also on our Facebook page, which is Facebook, or our YouTube page, youtube.com/c/iState. If you haven't subscribed, you should. And if you want to find everything, including this show, once I post it on YouTube, it'll magically appear on this page shortly after. And that is istv.me. Dude, is that easy to remember?
Istv.me.
I mean,
really easy.
That's really easy to remember. So I want to thank you very much, Eric July of Being Libertarian and Backwordz. And I'm Paul Gordon of iState. And I'll see you on the next unscheduled episode of iState. Oh, and real quick, Wednesday, I'm actually going to be doing two shows on this Facebook page. The first show is going to be with Donnie, if I'm pronouncing your name wrong, forgive me. Donnie Jabert, who is, he does U2030, and he's going to be talking about automating Congress. using the blockchain to create 300 million legislatures. Direct republic, if you will. So I think that's going to be fascinating. And then late, that'll be about 5 o'clock, 5-ish. And then about 9:30 or so, I'll be joined by Professor Rambo on Full Auto. And we're going to be talking guns in Europe and what should you be doing in the current climate. And that's it. I thank you all for joining us. Be blessed and don't stop calling each other commies and Nazis and talk to each other.